Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning to those of you in the main hall. Good morning to those of you on Zoom, and hello to those of you who are watching this later in the week. How good it is to see so many people here gathered to celebrate our 75th anniversary. Can you raise your hand if you traveled to be with us this weekend? Thank you. And can you rise and be recognized if you're coming back to UUFH after at least 3 years away? So welcome back, welcome home. And I'd like you to rise if you are able, if you were here when the Reverend Ralph Stutzman was the minister in the 1960s and 70s. And can you rise or raise your hand if you are now an adult but were a child who grew up in our RE program? We are so glad to have all of you with us today. And I am so glad that I am your minister at this time. I often think of church as a river. You've probably heard that expression, you can't step into the same river twice. It's based on a statement by the ancient philosopher Heraclitus of Ephesus, who said, life is like a river. We both step and do not step in the same river. We are and are not. So life is always changing, as you know, and so is a congregation. We are both the same and very different than we were at our founding in the 60s, in the 70s, in the 80s, in the 90s, in the aughts, in the teens, in the 20s. When I say 20s, do you think of 1920? That's us. Some of you have seen us go, those of you who stood up who were here in the 60s, you've seen us go through so many stages, some flourishing, some floundering, but here we are today. More than 212 members strong, almost 300 members, friends and children and teens, honoring our past, celebrating our present, and looking forward to our future. You have celebrated so much joy here. Let me ask you, raise your hand if you were married here. And how many of you named a baby here? So the anniversaries, the birthdays, the cabarets, the Renaissance fairs, the potlucks, the auction events, the Christmas Eves, the coming outs, and the calling ins. You have also shared each other's sorrows, the memorials, the devastating illnesses, the deaths, the divorces, the financial difficulties, the disappointments, the congregation controversies that led to some people no longer being with us, the worldwide pandemic. But for 75 years, you have created the Unitarian Universalist Fellowship at Huntington as your beloved spiritual home, a place to nurture your spirits and to help heal this world. For 75 years, you have sought the truth in love, you have helped one another, and you have brought justice to this community. You have taken the risks, you've dreamed the big dreams, you've raised the monies, you've educated the children, you've served the meals, you sat through thousands, if not tens of thousands, of committee meetings, and you've come back for more. You have made a difference in this world, my friends. You have saved lives. Perhaps this congregation saved your own. So let me offer to each of you on this 75th anniversary the words I use at baby namings and weddings. May this congregation bring you comfort in time of sorrow, aid in time of trouble, and the satisfaction of years spent well together. I wish for you and UUFH a full and happy future as together you seek your own answers and you bring justice to this world. It is now my pleasure to introduce to you the Reverend Dr. Bruce Marshall, who served as your settled minister from 1981 to 1992, who will offer you opening words.
It isn't easy to get to 75. I can preach that. I was born the same year as this fellowship, 1947. Trust me, it is not easy. And for this reason, this anniversary is to be noticed, commemorated, and celebrated. For 75 years, the UUFH has created a welcoming space for exploring religious questions, discovering our truths, supporting each other, witnessing for social justice, offering hope, and exploring how our liberal religious tradition may address the challenges and the opportunities of our lives. Not easy, but critical. It matters. And so let us welcome, rejoice, and come in. Please stand as you're able and join in singing.
It is my pleasure to welcome up to the chancel to light our chalice, Barbara Ratzlaff, whose husband Paul served you so well between 2004 and 2011. Would you welcome Barbara back? Reverend Jude Geiger will be leading the chalice lighting words. Reverend Jude served you from 2013 to 2021. Welcome back, Jude.
Good morning, everyone. I'm having weird flashbacks. I've been here before. Barbara and I have been here before, too, in Morristown. I was a kid, a teenager, when she was the First Lady of Morristown, and Reverend Paul was my minister as a teenager. Spirit of renewal, God of many names, source of love, remind us this hour of all the places and people that give us reasons for gratitude, for the spaces of quiet awe, that teach us grace and beauty exists in this world without striving or doing, that teach us grace and simply being is a gift to be valued, and we are all valued. We are grateful for the touchstones in our lives, that help us to feel whole when we feel lost or empty. Teach us to remember the joyous when we are lost in the painful, and remind us of the times that we ourselves have felt lost, when it is hard to be compassionate to another's difficulty. As this new school year begins, as the new year and the Jewish holy days begin, we reflect on another year past, another summer slipping away. May the warmth and rest, wherever it was found, stay with us, along with the memories of a summer, of a lifetime. Help us to take a breath, keep their fondness near to our hearts, and begin the work and study of another year with gratitude and purpose. As a community coming together in strength after a summer of work, of travels, of hobbies, of projects, we recommit to our mission of nurturing our spirits in community and caring for one another's and ourselves and helping to heal the corners of the world in which we dwell. So gather this community this hour. May every candle lit hold witness to our hopes and silences, hold witness to the love that is before us and the stories that have brought us this far. Our community is beginning its next move along the path of ministry for the next 75 years. May its going be for gladness and possibility. And may your ministry together be for healing and transformation. And may this fellowship continue to have the strength to travel down this road together with your spirit of peace. And I'll close, inspired by Reverend Deborah Hafner, with the words that we use these last 8.5 years for child dedications. With this water, with this flame, with this community, I bless your lips so that your words will be truthful. I bless your hands so that your deeds will be a service to life. I bless your head so that your thoughts will be loving. May you be blessed and kept through all your long years. Amen.
Please join me now in singing Common Ground. The words were written by Maria Nielsen, and the music was composed by Richard Hyman, our former choir director, who is here to also play.
My name is Sandra Jens, and my pronouns are she, her. I'm the acting Sunday school coordinator here at the UUFH. I grew up also in this religious education program here at the UUFH in the 1980s and 1990s. Our Time for All Ages this morning is a terrific RE video that Carolyn D'Arazio, Alex Wolf, and some of the children in the religious education program put together. It's comforting to know that our values that I learned as a child are the same values that are being taught today. Enjoy the video.
What is your favorite memory from your time in RE?
My favorite memory was picking raspberries next to the garden.
The thing that I did this year was doing the Wizard of Oz play.
My favorite memory from RE was the Easter egg hunt.
The Christmas patch.
One of my favorite memories is doing the Bug Hotel.
What was your favorite memory from RE?
I don't know.
Okay, Lila, what is your favorite RE memory?
I love playing with all the toys when I was in pre-K.
Playing in the garden.
What is one thing you learned in RE?
Pollinators. And what I learned that to help the environment and don't use pesticides on plants.
Something I learned in RE was not to judge people who they based on who they are or who they love.
In RE, I learned to search for what is true from the eight principles.
And one thing I learned about is the little red wagon. Kindness.
And what have you learned in RE?
To be kind and help others.
Thank you.
Hi, my name is Julia Barish. My pronouns are she, her, hers. And one of the things I've learned in RE is, well, I've learned many things from RE. One of the more important things I think I've learned is that to always listen to other people's opinions or thoughts on something, because while it may not be your own, it's always important to listen, because maybe that's more of what you were thinking and you just didn't know how to word it. And it's also important, even if it's not what you were thinking and it may be the opposite, it's important to hear other sides of the story and learn about people.
Thank you so much to Carolyn. Oh, thank you so much to Carolyn, Alex, and the children for creating this video. We'll now sing the pre-K and kindergartners out to their religious class to go to the song "Go Now in Peace," written by former music director Richard Hyman.
During this time in our service, we generally have an opportunity for you to light a candle of a moment, a milestone, a joy, or a concern in your heart. This morning, because there's so much to do, we will be lighting one candle. Lisa will light this candle for that which is holding in your heart this morning. I ask you to take a moment, to take a deep breath, to think about what this fellowship means to you, to think about the people who are no longer with us, who sat here, to extend our love to all who are hurting in our community, in our country, and in our world. And now I'd like to reintroduce to you and welcome up the Reverend Beth Graham, who served you from 1994 to 2003.
So before we move more deeply into prayer, Deborah, I just want to, Reverend Deborah, I guess you guys say that now, Reverend Deborah, I'd like to thank you for being so gracious to invite we oldsters here. It's just wonderful to be in this room, and not every minister would invite the predecessors back, so thank you to Deborah for that. And secondly, I want to acknowledge my husband, Bill Scholes, is with me today, too. I wasn't sure he'd be able to come, but the weather, Ophelia, insisted on it because he didn't want me to drive here by myself, or I should say take the ferry. So we drove around from Massachusetts. So Bill's here, too, and I know he'd love to see you. So one of my favorite parts of the service, let us gather in meditation and prayer. First, we'll sit for a moment more with our own thoughts in the blessing and comfort, in the stillness and silence, in gratitude for this home. And then we will hear words spoken, followed by our voices joined together in a beloved choral response. So let us sit with one another and just breathe. O Spirit of life, there is majesty in this moment. Grandeur in part because we celebrate 75 years of this congregation calling itself a people. But the mightiness right now moves far deeper than that. For with this gathering, we, these people, are a once-in-a-lifetime happening. Never has this precise collection of souls met together, and never will we do so again. It is thus, every Sunday, when this space and the adjacent Zoom room are filled with people and faces and bodies choosing to be together. It has been thus since 1947 when we first gathered, and it is thus for every congregation of every sort, always. That is the majesty of our gathering, the poignancy of the ephemeral. But what about the mystery of this moment? What of the inscrutable that is invoked by our familiar hymn, gathered here in the mystery of the hour, gathered here in one strong body? The mystery lies in the fact that who we are, whenever we are together, includes the right now, these breathing souls we sit with and Zoom with, while also including in our embrace ripples and waves of those who came before, those who shaped this home during their years among us, adults and children, one and all, those beloveds inscribed on the memorial wall anchoring this room, as well as those whose names we can't recall. The pulses and impulses of these bygone fellow travelers are part of our presence here. So too, we are enlivened by those who are yet to join our home. We know that this congregation did not begin with us, and our fervent prayer is that it will not end with us. That is the mystery of this hour. Today, yesterday, and the countless Sundays yet to come, gathered here, gathered now, gathered as one for 75 years, gathered between memory and hope, we give thanks. Gathered here in the mystery of this hour, gathered here in one strong body, gathered here in the struggle and the power, Spirit, draw near. Amen.
Each week, we have a collection for our split plate program.
That means that undesignated donations are split between the UUFH and our charity of the month, unless you indicate otherwise. This month, we're supporting the Maui Strong Fund of the Hawaii Community Foundation, which is providing financial resources to support immediate and long-term recovery needs for the people and places affected by the devastating Maui wildfires. Your donations today support the work we do both within and beyond our walls. Thank you, as always, for your generosity.
Thank you.
Thank you, choir. That was stunning. Can we give them a round of applause? Thank you. I want to acknowledge several people in the choir this morning are returning to us, and know that you have an invitation to come regularly. What a joyful noise, and thank you, Richard, for joining Dr. J this morning. You are a wonderful team to have. Reverend Nancy Arnold served you as your interim for 18 months in 2012 to 2013. She was unable to be with us today, but she sent a video.
Good morning, everyone. It's wonderful to be with you from afar. Thank you, Reverend Deborah and Liza, for inviting me to be part of today's celebration. Our ministry together was relatively brief. You chose the 18-month option for interim ministry. And I have to tell you, you made my job easy. After celebrating Reverend Paul Ratzlaff's retirement, you were eager to move forward. Trying to keep up with you was sometimes a challenge for me. But as my first interim placement, I too was eager to learn and move forward. You should know, though, that you spoiled me for the ministries that followed. You never forget your first. My initial impression of the fellowship was of a very competent lay-led congregation that cared deeply for its members and each other. The piece that was more of a mystery was how fond you were of your ministers as well. I remember telling you early on that you could learn some of the tools of ministry you might need, but the kind of care and compassion you displayed toward one another was not something that could be taught. You either had it or you didn't. It was clear that you had it, and you still do. I can't say the same for your ability to make major decisions as a congregation, particularly when it came to altering the building. And then there was the parking lot. But you've obviously done a lot of work on the property and on yourselves. Your vision statement reflects a very different attitude than the one you had even 10 years ago. Your commitment to capital improvements of your buildings and grounds so that they're accessible and better serve your mission is quite visible in the work you've done. The building looks fabulous, well cared for inside and out, and unless I'm mistaken, you have a paved driveway and a parking lot. Congratulations and alleluia. In the second year of our ministry, we shifted the focus of Commitment Sunday from a traditional canvas approach that asked, what does the fellowship need, to a stewardship campaign. You considered what you, the people, needed. People needed a place to worship, a caring community. People needed an opportunity to live meaningful, spiritually healthy lives. The appeal for stewardship asked you to make your financial commitment reflect your relationship with your faith community. You wanted your gifts to count for more than just paying the bills. I don't remember how successful the campaign was, but Reverend Jude saw something of value here when he accepted the call to be your next minister. Since we worked together, the fellowship has grown and lived into the potential I witnessed during my tenure. Now, once again, you're in a process of discernment between settled ministries, and you couldn't have a better partner for this work than Reverend Deborah. I offer you all my blessings and love on the 75th anniversary and many, many more years of nurture and caring for one another in this, your spiritual home. Blessed be.
So I knew that I couldn't offer my dear colleagues the opportunity to do a full sermon because we would have been here all afternoon. And so I decided to adapt one of the dialogues that I've done with you by inviting them to think about their time here and to share with you. And so we're going to have a series of questions for the next 15 or 20 minutes. So Bruce, welcome back. A lot's changed since you were here.
A lot's changed.
Bruce was the minister when you built this room, which could be the answer to this question. But, but as you think about your tenure, Bruce, talk about what you're most proud of.
Well, yeah, well, I was here during the time that this building was built. It was renovated and the chapel was built, converted a very romantic building and a very quirky building into a facility that actually could serve the needs of this congregation. That was a big accomplishment. Miles and miles of committee meetings, as they say. But what I'm most proud of is something else. It was what that building represented. It was a commitment by this congregation, by the members of this congregation, to this community, a commitment to this building on this property. Several other things happened during my tenure here which kind of pointed in the same direction. There was the establishment of the Memorial Garden, which recognized our commitment, our memory, our relationship to those who came before. There was also a strong young adults group, which opened the community to a new generation. And also we spent a lot of time just thinking about how the fellowship should operate. How do we treat each other? How do we take care of each other? How do we finance this place? What are the procedures that we want to follow throughout all these tasks? And taken all together, there was that commitment. There was that commitment to the future of this as a vital religious community. And that's what I'm most proud of during my tenure.
Thank you. So Beth, 1994 to 2003, what are you most proud of during your time?
Well, other than hiring Richard. I love doing worship with Richard. I just have to say that. It was blessing, blessing, blessing. There's a micro and a macro thing that's been in my mind since you posed this question. On the macro level, on the larger level, what I'm proud of is how we were brave enough to open up the dialogue of spiritual diversity and the different ways that we understand creation and how grand it is and how narrow it can become if you're strident in your definition of what's holy or what's precious. And we're really proud of that. That was not easy. It's also one of the harder things that we did, but I'm proud that that was something we were all committed to doing and still taking care of each other, as Bruce indicated from his years here being a community. But that was real work, and I'm proud of what we did. So that's on the larger sort of thematic level. On the micro level, I cannot think about this congregation without remembering 9/11. And I say that, you know, with a quaky voice because it was real. It was here. There are people in this room who came here because of 9/11. And yeah, I see some hands, and I know who you are. I remember vividly and feel blessed by the fact that we had an intern, Allison Cornish, here at that time. And had there not been two of us, I don't know how I would have done it as a religious professional. That the congregation knew we needed to come together and be together and figure this out while we're grieving, we did that well. And this room holds so many memories for me of that. I'm remembering a congregant who was then a reporter for Newsday, who came in to check how I was doing a couple of days after 9/11. And he took me outside and he said, "Smell that air, Beth. That's urban warfare smell." This is a man who had reported from places around the world. And the wind blowing and that smell, and here we were, and whew, we figured it out together and welcomed new people into this midst. And again, as Bruce said, you know, how lucky I was to follow him. We were a strong congregation who knew how to be scared and how to support each other and how to welcome new people. And we did that well, and I'm really proud of that.
Thank you. Thank you for your service. So Jude, tell us, what, when you think about your time here, those 8 years, what are you most proud of?
Well, I had begun to think a bit about what Reverend Nancy Arnold was talking about, but as always, it's difficult following an interim minister that everyone loves, like Nancy, so I won't talk about what she said, but I was proud with seeing that the vision and mission that you articulated 10 years ago now is something that your previous interim minister could see you live into over a decade, and that's something to take seriously, because not every interim minister is going to be able to say that to a congregation 10 years later. For me, I think it was more about how this congregation endured and thrived through so much transition. I recognize a lot of faces here, and I remember a lot of faces that aren't here anymore, and who are in the memorial garden that was built, that are in the air here, that was kept alive and strong from a generation of RE teachers that came around your time, that have made that life possible to rebuild and rebuild in times of difficulty. But I also realized, living in Long Island during this rise of fascism in our country, and we had a lot of painful, difficult conversations over my 8.5 years here, and there were times when what was being said in this room was not being said down the street anywhere. And to be able to the folks had stayed engaged in Black Lives Matter, in engaging with the reality of white supremacy and the increasing reality of totalitarianism in our country, in an area where religious organizations are really hesitant to talk about it. It gives me a new appreciation for your conversations around humanism and theism. I only do this for a living, right? But to be part of a place that stayed engaged with the successes of before, I mean, Reverend Paul Ratzlaff was instrumental with this community in starting up a shelter system for migrants. And during our tenure, things have changed with COVID, of course. There's nothing, you can't control the world, right? But you and we adapted. 1,000 pounds of vegetables growing, and now you're raising honey to be sold out for the pantry. I mean, the everyday things in a time in our nation where we all feel powerless often, a place that you can do, you know, I can do this one small thing, I can stay engaged. That spirit is good. It's good, a thing to be proud of. Thank you all for sharing that with me. Thank you.
So I asked each of your previous ministers to think about what was difficult about serving here. And as we are going into the surveys, and how many of you have filled out your survey? Okay, how many of you are gonna fill out your surveys? Thank you, we need your surveys. As you are thinking about and setting, thank you, Joanne, right? As you are thinking about your next step, I think it's also, as we've been working on during my time with you, time to confront some of the difficult things. And so I've asked each of the ministers to briefly share with you, as Nancy Arnold did, what's challenging about serving UUFH?
Well, I experience this congregation as a high energy congregation. I've been in high energy congregations, I've been in low energy congregations. High energy congregations are much more fun, but they can be exhausting. And I remember during my times, we would get to the end of a big project, and I would think, okay, let's take a breather. And somebody would come along and say, oh, now let's do this. And everybody else would say, yay. And we'd be off and running. The problem with that is not that it just wears out the minister, The problem is what it seemed to mean for membership in the congregation. It was, during my time, it was kind of all or nothing. You were totally involved or you're outside of the circle. I think we owe it to congregation members to offer a range of ways of participating, a variety of levels of commitment. I think a healthy congregation has those levels, and I don't think we really managed it during my time here. So that's one thing that I regret.
I love what Nancy and Bruce have said, so rather than repeating any of those things, not that I have a long list, Deborah, but I have a few things. I will say, and Jude will probably be mad that I'm saying this rather than letting him. It's safer that way. Does the word processing mean anything to all of you? The endless processing of everything, from whether when the cremains would go in the memorial garden they had to be pulverized or not. I remember a forum on that and hearing people stand up saying, I didn't even know pulverized cremains were versus non-pulverized cremains, but boy, we learned a lot. I learned a lot. But so that is exhausting, not just for the ministers, but I think also for some of you members to be able to say, okay, consensus is good, but you know, at one point, some point, you need to just make a decision, move on, and live with it. And I know that that is challenging, and I also know that on the other side of that yin yang, that you process everything and everyone has a voice and you care about each other is also in the heart and soul of how loving and caring you are as a congregation. So I think balancing those challenges has always been, balancing those dynamics has always been a challenge for this congregation, and it certainly was a challenge in my time too.
He took the first thought, she took the second. The phrase I would say to leaders at the time was, so what redecision do we want to redecide this time? We did that before. Do we want to go through that again now? And it usually would work, but it took a long time to get to there. And it's indicative of a place that's accomplished as much as it's accomplished. I mean, it's kind of amazing to do what y'all have done over the years. With those two out, I would have to say this place has a challenge around authority and shared ministry and what it means to have power with rather than power over. And I think that congregations have a range where they make mistakes when the minister is an executive in all things, and they make mistakes when the hired professional has to get clearance in all things. And that's something to think through over the next ministry. It's a power dynamic, but it's also a trust dynamic. And sometimes as someone who is coming in and committing their life and making a lot of choices to be with you all, it can get emotionally hard to have every decision challenged at length.
You've all heard that from me too, haven't you?
She is a wise mentor.
So I did ask them then to tell a funny story, because ministry is joyful, and then there are the things that kind of, when you look back, they just make you laugh. So Bruce, share a funny story.
Well, you know, funny can also mean strange. And when I think strange, I think of the tower that towered over this property. And you've got a very nice display here of the tower, some artifacts and some photos of what it used to be. It was it was built as a water tower to supply water for the McKesson Brown estate. But by the time the fellowship got it, it was not holding water. The insurance company, the property insurance companies, classified the tower as an attractive nuisance. Attractive in that it brought things to happen which were not supposed to happen around there, hence the nuisance. So we couldn't get insurance except through Lloyd's of London, which required that we put a fence around the tower to restrict access, which we did most of the time. But sometimes after a Sunday service, we would open up the gates of the fence and invite people to climb a very scary inside staircase up to the top. You had to be careful because you could slip on the pigeon guano that was had built up over the ages. But when you got to the top, you were rewarded with this incredible view of the neighborhoods all around, all the way down to Long Island Sound. And I remember times when somebody came up and brought a flute and would play from there, and somebody would bring a guitar, and somebody else brought snacks, because it was the fellowship after all. But we had to take the tower down for a variety of reasons, one of which was it sat right here, where we are sitting right now, and we needed space for the sanctuary. So we hired a demolition company to come in and take down the tower. So he showed up with a crane and a one-ton wrecking ball. And I was here, I remember it. The wrecking ball swung to the tower and hit the side of it, and the stucco shattered. Just kind of came down in a heap. But that revealed an inner core of reinforced concrete. The one-ton wrecking ball bounced off of it. They brought a three-ton wrecking ball that was similarly ineffective. And finally, they were reduced to bringing jackhammers and just chipping away at that tower slowly for weeks. That's what we all heard, the jackhammers chipping away at the tower and going after those reinforcing rods, which you also have one there too. Until finally, the tower was a pile of rubble, which got moved to a landfill somewhere. I used to know where, I don't remember anymore. But we also kept some bits and pieces of it. There's some over there also. I have my own piece of the rock. I still use it. it's a great paperweight. I think the tower is still in the DNA of the fellowship. It was a whimsical structure. And I think a little whimsy is very important to have at the center of a congregation.
So just as funny can be strange, funny can also be funny after the fact, not during. Often that's the case. So I'll share this memory, and Jim, it's not about Pam throwing up on my shoes on Christmas Eve. It's not that memory. That's a freebie. So those of you who were part of the congregation when I was here know that I'm pretty compulsive about lists and organizing things, including worship. And I remember one All Saints Day worship service where I really thought through this whole service and had candles, not in that nice tray like you have, but stand-up candles in a planter with sand, you know, make sure they were safe. Everybody had a chance to come up and light a candle in memory of somebody who had passed on or whom they were remembering. Really beautiful. The prayer, beautiful. I had this prayer. I was standing there saying the prayer. The candles were all lit. And all of a sudden I heard a commotion, and I looked down and the candles had joined each other, melted, hit the planter, which was resin and on fire. And Dick Kopp, I believe, is in this room today, Dick and Cynthia. Dick, thank God, leapt up and put water on this and put it out before half the congregation's eyes were open from my prayer to see that the implosion was happening. And holy moly, I don't know how I got through the rest of that service. So Dick, I've long wanted to thank you for saving this room, I guess, you know? And it was funny after the fact, not then.
So I take it your prayer was answered in real time, right there? I'm going to stick with the funny after, strange thread, and I'm going to take a riff off of Bruce's pigeon rodent story. And this is a quick story in two parts, but it'll tell you the range of your experiences here at Unitarian Fellowship of Huntington. So we were, I walked out of a service one day into social hour, when we were having our social hours out where we do now, and I saw a bunch of grade schoolers walking around with clipboards, which is either cute or you know you're in trouble as a senior minister. And it turned out that the grade schoolers discovered, and I didn't know this was the fact, but it was a fact, the grade schoolers found out that we were dealing with mice, rodents, in the kitchen with glue traps or snap traps, I don't remember which. And they had been going around with the clipboard to start up a petition to change them to safety, safer trap, catch and release, have a heart traps, right? Talk about the marketing on that. And they're like, we want to have a petition and we want to fight this. And I'm like, my first thought is, oh my God, the third graders are upset with me. I've lost already. No, let me sign this. And I signed this. And then my next thought is, oh my God, a petition. They're going to call a congregational meeting. It took 30 years to get the parking lot done. This is no, I need to put my foot down somewhere. So I run to the administrator at the time, who's Susie, and I said, Susie, make this go away. It cannot get to a congregational forum. And so it got resolved quickly. So that's the story of when executive authority is important, right? The other side of this, which is why lay leaders making sure the roof stays up and the ground stays dry are important. A few years later was when Danielle Burby was our RE coordinator and Greta Jo Seidel, who's now an ordained UU minister, was our intern. And I came in, it was early, it was about 9:05, 9:10. I'm about to open my office door and I had that feeling like when you know this day is not going to turn out well. And I open the door and the room looks off. Something feels like it's not where it's supposed to be, but I can't quite figure out what I'm looking at. Then I realize my plants are in disarray on the desk, and then there's bloody footprints on the windows and my keyboard. Apparently, when the roof was not yet quite fully repaired, a squirrel fell in and then fell into the drop ceiling. Thank you for words. I have them anywhere else. And it was horrible. So it's not funny now. But at the time, the brand new educator and the brand new intern had to hold my hands, walk me into the other office to sit me down. I'm like, I'm sorry. I am not equipped to handle this at all. And Greta Jo's trying not to laugh at me because she comes from the Midwest. And she's later on, she told me, my grandma would just gotten a gun and taken care of it there. Not funny then, funny now. That squirrel was rescued.
I'm looking at you, Ken, because the first time I met Ken and he was interviewing me to do like putting the dots on the final line for me to take this job, I'm having a meeting with the president and the ceiling in the office is pouring water. And then he goes and he gets a bucket and a mop, and he interviews me while he's bringing out the floor. And I have to tell you, I really had to think whether that was a bad omen for this job. But it told me that you all roll up your sleeves and go with the flow, literally. So, yeah. So I asked each of your prior ministers, if in two sentences, what do you wish for UUFH for the next 75 years?
My wish is that this congregation continues to engage with our liberal religious tradition to guide us in our task of building a better life, of making a more just community and a more humane world. God knows we need it.
And mine is that you continue to be relevant, this place continues to be relevant to the current times that it will find itself in, that you continue to love each other and know how to take care of each other, and you continue to love and honor your ministers and the gifts that they bring.
Ditto. I was so happy going last before. Play to your strengths. By my time, the last year I was here, I think we had four lay-led touchstone small group ministries, and there were four that I was leading, Bellspring. They were meeting twice a month for the year. I really saw them make a difference in how this congregation communicated with one another. It really reduced conflict, and it's what you're here for, caring for one another. You've heard your former ministers talk about how well you pastor to one another. Get to know each other. Make regular commitments to one another. That's the first thing. Everything else follows.
Thank you. So thank you to each of you. To you all, although I think we all agree that baked into your fellowship, going back to that 1962 30-30 vote, whether you wanted to have a minister or not, baked into that ambivalence is also, though, an incredible fondness, regard, and care for the people who serve you. And so I'd like to ask you to recognize my three colleagues and all they gave you. Down, unless you have to, and then of course sit down. We are going to sing together what I know is one of your favorite hymns, Peter Mayer's Blue Boat Home.
May the life that we share in this fellowship now be returned to each of us, to give us strength, to bring us hope, to warm our paths as we go our separate ways.
And now go out into the world in peace. Have courage. Hold on to what is good. Return to no person evil for evil. Strengthen the faint-hearted. Support the weak. Help the suffering. Honor all persons again and again and then again.
For those who see God, may God be with us. For those who embrace life, may life return our affections. For those who seek a right path, may a way be found and the courage to take it, move by move. For this is the day we are given. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Amen.
My friends, go in peace. You can join me. May our real service begin.
Our postlude today is "We Have Only Just Begun" by the Carpenters. And we are to join in with our choir.
Thank you.
What a wonderful moment that we've shared this morning. For those of you at home, we wish you a peaceful day. For those of you who are here, the party is not over. We have a wonderful brunch served in the social hall. The selfie station in the family room from last night is still here. You can continue to sign your name so we know that you were here for our archives, and also add the names of people that you wish to remember on the wall. Please go in peace. Please greet our ministers. Thank you, Reverend Deborah, for a beautiful and moving service, and Reverend Jude, Beth Graham, and Bruce Marshall. I unfortunately have a few announcements, but you can go. You can go while I'm speaking. Please complete your surveys. We have to, so because we have our future to think about, right? We're our new minister. We also are selling honey today that was created in, but I don't know how to say it. it's from our garden. It's been a long weekend. And also, I'm not going to read the whole thing, but remember last night Sue McGovern talked about our 75th anniversary legacy circle to help provide for generations to come. There's a box in the back and cards for you to fill out as you think about leaving your money to the fellowship for our future. Thank you, and have a wonderful day. Go and party.